Okay, so hello, my name is Piotr Wojciechowski. I'll be presenting analyzing the reachability problem in choice networks. This is work, joint work between myself, Dr. Suramani, and Dr. Velasquez. So this work has been funded by the Air Force Office of Scientific Research. So the first thing I'll go, like just a brief like recap of what a traditional directed network is, how our network differs from traditional networks, like what type of problems it can represent. And then I'll go into the problems we're studying and the results we have obtained. So in a traditional network, you're given a vertex set, an arc set, a start vertex, and a cost. So you have your vertex set, which contains your start and target vertices, an edge set at set E, which contains your arcs, a cost function, which gives you a cost for each arc. And you can like represent here, like a vertex, just a traditional network here. You have these five edges, five arcs, like one from S to V1, one from S to V2, so on. And then you can like ask certain problems, like what is the shortest path from S to T? So here, like if you go through V1, you have a path of cost 3. If you go through V2, you have a path of cost 4. So, and then this is the shortest path problem, which is just simply asking, given a directed network, a start vertex, target vertex, what is the path from S to T with lowest cost? So what we're interested in is a variation of these networks known as choice networks. In a choice network, in addition to the information you're given in a regular directed network, you're also given a set of arc pairs. And you're interested in paths which don't use both arcs from any one of these pairs. So you're given your, again, you have a definition of a graph. So this time you have your vertex set V, your arc set E. This time you're given a pair, like set of pairs of arcs, which like are these forbidden pairs for your network. You're again given a cost. And so now we can look at how a choice network looks like. So here you're given a set of vertices, then you can have arcs here, like one from S to V1, one from S to V2, one from V1 to V3, one from V2 to V3, one from V3 to V4, one from V3 to V5, and then from both V4 and V5 to T. And then we can define a choice set on these arcs. So for example, our first pair could be the arc SV1 and the arc V3V4. Our second pair can be the arc SV2 and the arc V3V5. Similarly, you could have a third pair and a fourth pair. So we see here, in this case, the pairs of arcs are disjoint, but they don't necessarily need to be. And then what we can ask is several questions, like for the type of graph, like first of these being the optional choice reachability problem, which is given a choice network, do you have a valid path from S to T? So can you get from S to T without using both arcs from any one pair? So for example, if we go back to the network we had before, we can now look at what happens if we try to go from S to T. So if we go from S to T, we either have to go through V1 or V2. If we go through V1, then here we use an arc from pair S1 and an arc from pair S3. Since we use an arc from pair S1, we can't use the other arc from that pair, so we can no longer go from V3 to V4. Since we use an arc from pair S3, we can no longer go from V5 to T. So we see that going along this path has cut off all possible ways to reach T. Similarly, if we went the other way through V2, then we're using an edge from pair S2 and an arc from pair S4. So since we use an arc from pair S2, we can't use the other arc, so we can't go from V3 to V5. And since we use an arc from pair S4, we can't go from V4 to T. So once again, we can no longer reach the target vertex. And so in this graph, we see that like with the arc pairs constructed as they are, we can no longer reach S from t. Like no matter which way we start, we always completely cut off t being reachable from s. So these type of networks can represent communication networks in which certain communication pathways have been compromised. Like, for example, a pair of arcs can represent a pair of pathways which have been compromised by the same source. And so using one arc from each of these pairs will reveal some information about what's being communicated, but not enough to completely compromise the communication. However, using both arcs completely compromises your communication. So this is something you want to avoid. And so these type of networks we're using here represent this type of communication problem. They can also represent networks which have to undergo maintenance. So certain pathways may be undergoing maintenance. And so maintenance can be performed under like on pairs of arcs. So while one arc is being used, the other arc can be undergoing maintenance. And so if we use both arcs from a pathway, then like we can't perform a maintenance on either arc. So if we want to like be able to maintain arcs in this graph, we want to be able to once again avoid using both arcs from any one of these pairs. And the other additional problems we're looking at here, this time instead of just asking, are we reachable, like is the source reachable from the is the destination reachable from the source? We can also ask, what is the shortest path? So using two different measurements. So one being the measurement using the fewest arcs, and one being the path with the lowest total cost. So a related problem is the problem where you have graphs with forbidden transitions. So like if you basically in one of these graphs, you're given, like if you enter a vertex using one arc, then there are certain arcs you can no longer use to exit that vertex. So this is a variation on the choice network. However, here, instead of being just giving general pairs of arcs, your pairs of arcs have to have one arc entering a vertex, one arc leaving that same vertex. So this is a like restricts what type of arcs can be in these pairs. And this has been studied like in a paper published in Discrete Applied Math by Stefan Jeider. So the reachability in these graphs with forbidden transitions is NP complete, as shown in the in Stefan Jeider's paper, and it is still NP hard on grid graphs. So before I continue on into our results, I will go into some of the like different complexity classes we're using, because for these, for especially for the like optimization problems where you like we're looking at, we have complexity results which show inapproximability, like based on not just you can't get better than this approximation factor, it falls within like other complexity classes based on this approximation. So for approximation classes, approximation problems, you can ask, is there a constant factor approximation? Like if there's not a constant factor approximation, you can ask, is there a log factor approximation? If there's not a log factor approximation, you can ask, is there a polynomial factor approximation? And to answer some of these questions, like you can, like especially for in the negative, you can use like complexity classes, and these complexity classes are established what are using what are known as PFAS reductions. So the classes like here we're going to be looking at are the class APX, the class NPOPB, and the class NPO. So the class APX like is the class of problems which do allow constant factor approximations. And then within this, you have APX complete problems which do not allow PTASs, so or FPTASs, unless P equals NP. And for example, a problem like this is minimum vertex cover. Above that, you have the class NPOPB. So these are NP optimization problems in which the optimization function is bounded by a polynomial in terms of the problem size. And you have NPO complete problems which do not even don't have log factor approximations. They don't have polylogarithmic factor approximations unless P equals NP. An example of this is minimum ones, which is saying, like, if you're given a SAT formula, what is the assignment with the minimum number of true variables? And then at the above that, you have the class NPO, which is the class of NP optimization function. In this case, you don't even have a restriction on the value of the optimization function. And again, you have NPO complete problems, which do not allow even polynomial factor approximations unless P equals NP. And an example of this is the traveling salesman problem. To establish completeness within these type of approximation classes, you can't just use regular reductions. You have to use reductions which in some sense preserve the approximation factor, saying that if you have an approximation here, like for this problem, you can't get it better than this approximation here. And so one way of doing this is through p-test reductions. Like here, a p-test reduction, you're given three functions, f, g, and alpha, each of which is computable in polynomial time, one of which maps instances of the problem p to the instances of the problem q. Then the function g, which maps solutions which are within 1 plus alpha of epsilon to the like instance generated by f, to a solution to the original instance, which has an approximation error of at most 1 plus epsilon. So here we see that an approximation on one gives you an approximation on the other. So if you have one problem which is inapproximable within some amount, the problem you're trying to reduce to that will also be inapproximable to a similar within a similar amount. And p-test reductions are used to establish completeness in these approximation classes. So a problem p is APX complete if every problem in APX can be p-test reduced to that problem. And the same holds for NPO completeness and NPO PB completeness. So now that I've covered the classes that we're using, I'll finally like go into the results we have obtained for the problems I've described. So like the problems were like the approximation like results we're getting will be based on the minimum ones problem and the weighted minimum ones problem. So as I mentioned before, the minimum ones problem is you're given a 3CNF formula phi, and what is the minimum number of true variables in any satisfying assignment to that formula? And then the weighted minimum ones problem is you're given a variable weighted 3CNF formula phi, and you want to find the minimum weight of true assignments. So, and the minimum ones problem is NPO PB complete because here, like the value you're optimizing is bounded by the size of the problem because the minimum number of true variables in the assignment is bounded from above by the number of variables in the equation. And the weighted minimum ones problem is NPO complete because you no longer have that restriction because your weight function can be arbitrary. And both of these results are in Vigo-Kahn's. So to establish the results we have obtained, the inapproximability results we have obtained for these problems, we will take a 3CNF formula and then from that formula construct a choice network like from that formula such that the source S is reachable from the destination if and only if the formula is satisfiable. Each path from S to T corresponds to a satisfying assignment. And then the length of that path is based on the number of true variables. And in fact, the number of edges in that path is directly computable from the number of true variables. And the weight of that path is equal to the total weight of true variables. So this like relationship between the number of true variables and the number of edges in the path, the weight of true variables and the weight of the path establish the like NPO and NPO PB completeness of our optimization problems. Like, so to go into a bit more detail about how this construction works, for each variable, we construct a pair of paths, one from one vertex to another. One path corresponds to setting the variable to true, and this has a large number of arcs. Then there's a much shorter path, which corresponds to setting the variable to false. And then each of these edges in these paths is paired with another edge, which will be later used to construct the like the gadgets we're using for the clauses. And then the upper path is constructed such that it has the weight of the variable correspond like for which it was constructed, and the lower path will have weight zero. So once we go through the gadget, if the variable is true, we have a total weight of zero, and the total length of the path is much longer than if the variable was false. And then for the clause gadget, we just simply have three paths, with each of which has two edges. And then these edges are paired with the, like basically paired with either the upper or lower path, depending on what literal was used in, like what literals are in that clause. And so here, like basically we can only traverse one of these paths if we have a true literal in the clause. So going from S to T, we go through each variable gadget, we go through each of these clause gadgets, and then we can only traverse each clause gadget if we have the like corresponding, if the variable is set such that there's a true literal in that clause. So we can only go through the entire thing if we have a satisfying assignment, and the length of the path corresponds to the number of true variables in that assignment. And so these are used to establish the PTAS reductions from the OCR optimization and WOCR optimization problems. And since the minimum ones problem is NPOPD complete, so is the OCR opt problem. Since the weighted minimum ones problem is NPO complete, so is the WOCR opt problem. And for our final result, like instead of just looking at this as an optimization problem, we're now trying to solve just the reachability problem. And for this, we have a FPT algorithm, like so a fixed parameter tractable algorithm. And the approach here is we take our choice network. For each pair, like for each of the pairs in our graph, we can choose to just remove an edge from the network. And then we no longer have to consider that as a pair. We can no longer use both edges since one is removed. So once that edge is removed, we're not going to make a choice for that pair. And once an edge is removed, we remove also certain paths from that graph. So certain other edges can now no longer be used by any path from S to T. So we can remove those additional edges. And then once we remove these additional edges from G, then we can essentially, this may reduce choices for future pairs in the graph. We remove edges from other pairs in the graph. And what we have shown is that if there is no path from S to T, then there's at least one pair, such as removing one edge from that pair, like, and then removing the edges which are no longer reachable from S, the edges from which we can no longer reach T, then we always remove an edge from at least one other pair. And so like making a choice for one pair makes a choice for two pairs. So we can, like, instead of making just two to the number of pairs choices, we make root two to the number of pairs choices. So in conclusion, what we have is we have that the optimize, like finding the path with the fewest edges is NPOPD complete. Finding the path with the minimum weight is NPO complete. We have a 1.42 to the size of the choice set algorithm for determining if T is reachable from S. And we also have shown, like I haven't described here, is that we like it's unlikely to be able to solve the decision problem in 1.18 to the power s time, and this was done through a reduction from SAT, and saying that through the strong exponential time hypothesis. So in the future, what we can do is here, like take the FPT algorithm and see if we can generate a kernel for this problem. and see if we can either improve our algorithm or improve the lower bound so we can get a tight lower bound for the problem, saying that here's an algorithm that runs in this amount of time and it's unlikely to be able to be solved any faster. So thank you. Any questions? Yes.
It's more of a comment than a question in the chat. Someone said, I'm reminded of alternative graph work in scheduling. Somebody in the chat mentioned that I'm reminded of alternative graph work in scheduling.
Just taking a further pointer. So there's simple temporal networks in scheduling. There's a variety of versions of those that add choices on edges.
Okay.
And so there might actually be a version of simple temporal networks that maps nicely into your choice network.
Okay. Yeah.
But I'm unaware of any complexity analysis like you've done on those networks. So it might be that you've got another application for what
you're doing. Okay, yeah. That, so like that is something we can look at, the temporal network, I guess.
Simple temporal networks. Makes sense.
Yes. Okay. Any other questions or comments? Yes.
In practice, how does it compare to a MIP model?
So we haven't yet implemented this algorithm. What we have, like, we do have, and we have like implement, like represented this using an integer program and solved that. So we do have a baseline to compare against. However, we haven't actually implemented our algorithm to compare against the MIP baseline. Any other?
Okay, thanks again.